since he was born. So our class is going to do that right now. And then right after, we're going to sing Joy to the World. And then I will hand it over to Mr. Pratt.
A long time ago, in a village called Nazareth, there was a young woman named Mary. One day, an angel of the Lord appeared to her.
Mary, you're blessed by God, and will give birth to His Son in the name of Jesus.
I happily serve the Lord, and His will be done.
Mary had married a man named Joseph, who was a carpenter. One day, Joseph had to go on a long trip to Bethlehem, and Mary followed him on the long, hard journey, even though it was almost time for her to give birth to her baby. Joseph led Mary to the stable where she gave birth to a baby boy.
His name is Jesus.
Nearby, there were some shepherds tending to their sheep in their fields. An angel of the Lord appeared to them and they were afraid.
Go away.
Yeah,
I'll
feel
you.
Don't be afraid. I bring a good news today. Born in today in Bethlehem. I save you with the Christ the Lord. You will find the baby wrapped in the spindly clothes in the manger.
The sky filled with angels saying glory to God and peace on earth, goodwill toward men.
Find a baby,
the angel
told us about.
Why, dear, let's go.
The shepherds went to Bethlehem to find Joseph, Mary, and baby Jesus. They worshipped him as he slept. Soon, three wise men arrived in Bethlehem.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Well, special thank you to the students for your presentation this morning. Thank you for your hard work. All right. Well, we know what the reason for the season is, and we praise God today that He sent His Son, Jesus, that we may have the privilege of spending eternity with God. And interestingly, we look to God, and traditionally, Christmas has grown to be a time where we expect stuff, I mean, we expect material, or the media promotes, we have to have this and that for it to really be Christmas. But all we need for Christmas is a Savior. And God saw that we have fallen short of the glory of God, and He sent His Son that we may have His Savior, that we may have the ultimate sacrifice, that we may spend eternity with God. And we praise Him for that today. Now, this is our last chapel of the year. And I want to go not in a different direction, but you all are visionaries, you all are leaders. So I'm going to point you to some things in the future. Now, what has happened in the past few years, individuals have come forth and they have looked with dread as in terms of what's going to happen in the future. They look with dread in terms of the new year. Oh, it's been a bad year so far, and I don't know what to expect in 2021. And I can remember before many of you were born, actually before all of you were born, when we were dreading Y2K, the year 2000, and they were saying the computer's going to crash, the financial markets are going to be disrupted. And I remember us anxiously sitting there at midnight, 11:59, waiting for our bank accounts to crash and everything like that. And at midnight of the year 2000, nothing happened. We continued business like normal. But what the media and different people like to promote is anxiety and stress and the negativity in going forward. And God says in Jeremiah 29, He says, I give you a hope and a future. And if He's giving you a future, He's pointing you forward. Yes, we've had hard times. Yes, we've had difficult times. But I'm telling you, there is a future in God, a future in Christ. Now, you may ask the question, what in the world do I have to look forward to in 2021? What do I have to look forward to? We're still battling coronavirus, and thank God they are releasing a vaccine and things like that to the market. What do we have to look forward to? The financial markets are up and down. What do I have to look forward to? The politicians are fighting all over the place. What do I have to look forward to? Well, we're going to discuss some things that we have to look forward to in the future. Those of you that are going into law and going into real estate and various industries, you're going to run across the terms covenant and irrevocable. A covenant is something that cannot be changed, it will not be changed, cannot even be changed by act of law. Something that's irrevocable means you can't stop it. And I'm telling you right now that God has some things for the future that are a covenant and are irrevocable. So let's go forward and see what God has for us in 2021. One thing we can expect in 2021 is God to guide us when we are facing confusion. In Proverbs 3rd chapter, verses 5 to 6, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, trust Him, and He will show you what path to take. See, when we get our eyes off the circumstances and get our eyes off what we know, because sometimes our knowledge may not be the best knowledge, but when you allow God and when you walk in the vision that God has, He will guide you. Now, we're talking about going forth in faith, because faith many times will exist in things we can't see. Faith will exist in things that we can't touch. Faith will exist in things that we can't measure. So don't be surprised at times that you're looking and trying to figure things out tangibly. But when you go forth in the heart of Christ and the mind of Christ, it's amazing. It's amazing how He protects you. You all are here today because of faith. You all are here today because somebody saw hope in the future in you and thought this would be the best place for you to be protected and go forth with your educational pursuits. What else can I expect in 2021? God promises to help you that when you're tempted. Their temptations are going to come. Things are going to come because we're human and we're fragile and we're looking for things that, trying to think of a mature way to say it, things that look good, and things that are enticing, and things, and many times those enticements are the very things that draw us off track. But you got to remember, 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says, all the temptations and the struggles you face are common among men. And God said he will give you either a way to stand it or a way to overcome it. You are going to face some things, and it's going to be hard sometimes. It's going to be hard. It's not going to make sense to go forth and do what God has told you to do. But if you go forth in faith, God will help you when you're tempted and when you're facing struggles. What else can I expect in 2021? God is saying that he will deal with those that have hurt you. There are individuals that have, I would hate to say, maliciously gone forth and have hurt people. And sometimes we hurt people by mistake. It is not for us to take vengeance. It is not for us to take the law in our own hands. God says he will deal with those that have hurt you and have wounded you. He even makes a warning. He said, touch not my anointed, touch not my prophets. Do them no harm. He said, those that will harm the least of my little ones, he said, it's better you put a millstone around your neck and jump into the sea than you hurt my little ones. So if you're out there, we're not talking to anybody in this room, but there are people out there with a mindset of hurting people and getting over on people. God will deal with that. Vengeance is not in your hands. Do not take the law in your own hands. Romans 12:19 said, never avenge yourselves. Leave that to the Lord. He said he will repay those who deserve it. He says God will fight for us. And in 2 Kings, when Jehoshaphat was going forth, and I related this story a number of times, his army, his military regiment was overrun. I was outnumbered and outgunned. And the people looked in stress. It's like, we got to be killed. This would have been the genocide at that time. But God, through the prophet Jehaziel, told Jehoshaphat, he said, you would not have to lift a finger. He said, the battle is not yours. The battle is the Lord's. You need to walk forth and understand that some of the fights and some of the things that you're facing now, it is not your battle. Get your hands out of it. Praise God. Seek God. Go forth in faith. And you'll be surprised what God will do on your behalf. One interesting thing that we've experienced, we've had people sadly hurt us and do things against us. And even recently, we're more than 3,000 miles from home. Some of you are more than 6,000 miles from home. And somehow we get word of how God has dealt with individuals and dealt with situations that have been very, very hurtful to us. What can we expect in 2021? We can expect God to give us wisdom. Now, the question is, what in the world is wisdom? Wisdom and knowledge are two different things. We can take knowledge, we can learn and get all the education we can. Matter of fact, in James 1:5, it says, if any of you lack wisdom, you should ask God, who will generously give you all without finding fault. It will be given to you if you seek God for wisdom. Now, what is wisdom? Wisdom is taking the knowledge that you have and properly applying it to a situation or a circumstance. But what we have to do is like, Lord, how do we do this? Say, for instance, you math experts, I'm not a mathematician, but we know the formula for the volume of a cylinder is pi r squared times the height. But you cannot apply that formula to the formula of a cube. So the knowledge, the formula for a cylinder, apply that to the cylinder and not the cube. I don't want to say elementary way of applying that. Apply the knowledge that God is giving you. Seek God. How should I handle this situation? How should I handle that knowledge? How should I, who can I go through and get the knowledge that I can apply to the situation? God will give you wisdom that you can apply in every circumstance, but you got to seek him. God promises that he's going to reward you for your service. There are individuals right now that they go forth, they give constantly. They give and sacrifice. They feed the hungry. They give clothing to the poor. They call people when they see they're in trouble. And Many times the enemy will come in and try to tell you, oh, nobody notices that. You're being used. You're wasting your time. But God says, those that give to the poor, he will repay. He said, if you give, he will give generously to you. He said, he will give back to you a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, where he calls other people to give, and give to you because of your service. Those that have been called to missions, those that have been called to feed the poor, those that have been called to feed your neighbor, those that have been called to just bless somebody. I see you all different times when God has put on your heart to give somebody just a little present, a little token, a little card. God blesses that. God sees that. And I praise God that he's put in your heart to do that. Now, Biggie, what can we expect in 2021? We can expect God to give purpose to our lives. And that is a tough one. Like, Lord, how in the world do we find purpose? How do we find out, Lord, what do you want us to do? And it can be hard when you try to figure out yourself, when you try to misapply knowledge and things like that, but when you seek him. But I'm going to give you some steps that you can apply to your life that kind of help direct you to a purpose. First thing, you need to turn to the Bible. You need to find the word that applies. Say, for instance, you want to go seek God about a profession. You want to seek God about various things. What I used to do is find every scripture I can about what I'm interested in, or what I'm curious about. Then the next, those of you that don't pray, you need to start praying. Get that word in you. The word in the Bible, how it applies to your life, and start praying to God with direction. Here, remember, we're talking about wisdom. We got the knowledge of the word now. Now you're praying for direction. That is seeking God for wisdom. Then next, in terms of finding your purpose, you need to follow the will of God. So with the word in your heart, you're praying to God for direction. Now you're seeking God, Lord, what is your will for my life? What do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? Who do you want me to touch? If you earnestly seek God for that, he will direct you. You need to, in addition to that, you need to understand the promises of God. I guarantee you, you start just searching the Bible for the promises of God. There's so many promises. He promises you hope in the future. He promised you eternity in heaven if you accept Jesus. There's so many things. He said that if you seek him, that he will give you the power to past behind you. But sometimes your past is outrunning you or running with you. But God said he would give you the power to put the past behind you and seek him and find purpose. But also you need to live a purpose-driven life. Now that's a famous book, but one, I'll put it this way. If you have a point in mind, if your purpose through the Lord is to be a doctor or be a lawyer, plot the path to that. What are you going to need to do to make it to that? Are you going to need to pass science and biology and chemistry and things of that nature? Those are things that point you into the direction of our profession. With law, are you going to need to understand the judicial processes? Are you going to need to understand the government and things of that nature? Those are things that point you in the direction of our purpose, if that's your purpose for life. If God's called you to ministry, get that word in you. Pray constantly. Seek opportunities to serve. Seek opportunities to minister. That points you in that direction. That's when I say purpose-driven. When I counsel individuals, we sit down and we plot a point in terms of what we are pursuing in terms of counseling. Some people are struggling with anxiety. Some people are struggling with stress. And we sit down and we map out a plan. Number one, identify the triggers and the causes of various things. And we map out a plan to get from anxiety to calm, to get from anxiety to peace. And that's another example of purpose-driven, solution-driven. We cannot, God didn't call us to sit still. God didn't call us to be stationary. He called us to move forward. And I'm telling you now, every circumstance of your life, you can overcome. You will overcome in Jesus' name. What else can I expect in 2021? We can expect God's love to be everlasting. Say, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. In Ephesians 3, Paul said, Lord, help me to understand how high, how low, and how wide God's love is. And in Romans 8, he said, nothing shall separate us from the love of God, neither height nor depth, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present No things to come will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. That is an irrevocable thing. Remember, we were talking about covenants and things that are irrevocable. God's love is irrevocable. He is not taking it back. He loves you. He says, while you were yet sinners, he died for you. While we were yet sinners, he showed his love by sacrificing his life on the cross. That is an irrevocable covenant. We spoke about that earlier. So all of you, I'm going to put it this way, if any of you are feeling unloved today, I'm telling you, you're loved unconditionally. Don't let unforgiveness. I'm not talking about unforgiveness for others. Unforgiveness for yourself. Cloud what God has for you, what God is saying to you. God demonstrating his love to you. Yes, we're going to have troubles. We're going to fall. We're going to make mistakes. But the thing is, get back up. Get back up. The disciples asked God, how often should we forgive? He said seven. No. The disciples said seven times? No. Jesus said 70 times seven. And that's in one day. So, and I did the math on that. If you sin every 2 minutes during your waking hours of the day, God, the forgiveness of God far exceeds that. Forgive yourself. Forgive yourself. And the trick is, you make mistakes, repent. Get back on your horse. Make a mistake, repent, get back on your horse. And eventually, you're going to become a practitioner of doing right. You're going to become a practitioner of doing what God has called you to do. But the thing is, put the past behind you and press forward. God has called you to move forward. God didn't call you to be stationary. He didn't call you to look back. He called you to look forward. Look forward to 2021. Stop stressing. Don't let the media, don't let anybody tell you, oh, here we are, another year of dread and things of that nature. God is pointing you to a hope and a future. And I just kind of touched on that. What can we expect in 2021? We can expect God to forgive us our sins. 1 John 1:9, it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, the thing is, and I'm guilty of this. There were times in my life, I had some things in my life that I wasn't proud of. And I was embarrassed to go before God. I was embarrassed to ask for forgiveness from various things. He said, whatever. He said, forgive us for all of your sins and provide you with a life of Forgive you for all of your sins and unrighteousness. You need to accept it that they understand that. That is another irrevocable covenant. God, once again, we talked about temptation. God promised in 2021, whatever your struggles are, he got it. He got it for 2021. He promised us also 2021 that he is going to fight for us. Sometimes we are fighting an enemy that we cannot see. And many times we are fighting a fight that is not our fight. Remember we were saying, like Jehoshaphat was told by the prophet, that the battle is not yours, the battle is the Lord's. In Judges 6, God called Gideon, one of my favorite characters in the Bible. And Gideon, in his mind said, I'm the lowest of the from the Lord's tribe. And my question has always been, who told him he was the lowest from the Lord's tribe? Apparently he had walked in a label that somebody put on him. Erase the labels, because God is calling you to do something miraculous. Many times, most times, God is going to call somebody that will, number one, go forth in faith, and then the world will look and say, it must have been the Lord that did this. God wants us to go forth in purpose, wants us to go forth in faith, trusting him every step of the way. We did an illustration of the boat. God told Peter, after Peter said, Lord, I've been trying to fish all night. I failed all night long. God directed Jesus to stand in Peter's boat. And when Jesus finished preaching, he told Peter, launch out into the deep. Now, Peter could have, in his knowledge, could have said, I'm the expert. I've been fishing all night. I haven't caught anything. But no, he said, Lord, I recognize your authority. And he launched out into the deep. Some of you all, no, all of us need to launch out into the deep. Now, I'm talking about, when I say the deep, I'm talking about launching away from all of our visible means of support, launching away from all of our perceived barriers, all our perceived, because sometimes we have tethers on our life that, oh Lord, I can only go this far, I think this was last year during spring break, we did a message on the circus elephant. A circus elephant, traditionally, Humane Society will have a fit about that now, but the circus elephant, traditionally, how they would train that elephant, they would attach a big chain, the biggest chain they could, to his leg and hammer it in the ground with a spike. And that elephant, as a baby, would kick and scream and struggle, and eventually got to the point where he knew if it was something on their leg, they weren't going anywhere. And it said that some elephants had gotten trained to the point that if you had a piece of fishing line and a toothpick in the ground, if they felt something was on their leg, they wouldn't go any further. Why? Because the elephant had been conditioned. The elephant has more than 30,000 muscles in his trunk alone. The elephant can carry hundreds, thousands of pounds on his back with no problem. But here, we had animals with all of that potential being tethered to defeat because of a standard that had been set. Those of you that are struggling right now in terms of getting away from established tethers, established boundaries and things of that nature, God is calling you right now in 2021 to break away from those barriers, break away from those limitations, break away from those things that have been spoken over you. I'm telling you right now, you all are so talented. You all are so gifted. You all have so much potential. There is so much in this room right now. Remember, one was in 1,000 a flight, two in 10,000, three, 100,000, four, 1 million. Seven people have the ability joined together in Christ to touch up 1 billion people. There's enough people in this room right now to shake the world. But what we fail to do, we fail to go forth in Christ because we're looking forward because somebody told us that we couldn't. We fail to go forth because somebody told us you don't meet our standard. But I'm telling you right now, you meet every standard in God when you step forth and you go forth in faith. What else can I expect in 2021? God is saying in 2021, expect him to fill you with joy. Expect him to fill you with a happiness. Now, don't be surprised if someone approaches you and want to know what in the world you're happy about. Even just yesterday, I was at the post office, stranger, never seen before. And he wanted to know, do you know God? Are you walking with God? Never seen him before, had no. And next thing you know, we're talking about God. We're talking about the gifts of the Spirit. We're talking about various things. Why? Because the joy of the Lord was in me. He said if you lift him up, he said he would draw people to you. Now, be cautious. Be cautious in terms of who are around you. There's some people out there that don't mean you any good. Once again, go forth with wisdom. There's some places God's going to take you. Don't go. There's some people God's going to take you. Don't talk to. There's a go forth in wisdom. We are not supermen and superwomen. God will protect us. But if he directs you, don't go here. Please, please, I'm telling you. Because I'm going to tell you the biggest mistakes, all of the biggest mistakes I've made in my life is because I chose to do it my way. All the biggest mistakes I've had in my life is because I didn't listen to God. And there are times when my mistakes could have cost me my life. Back in 1991, I was at a club. Mind you now, I went to church that afternoon. Later that night, I'm in a club. God told me, don't go to that club. But I had to go. I'm hanging around people I shouldn't have hung around. God told me, don't hang around those people. What did I do? Once again, I violated what God told me to do. I was disobedient. On the way home, the axle broke on my car and the car rolled over. I could have been dead that night, but God in his wisdom, here I am in a car upside down, gas leaking in the car, couldn't get the doors open, finally kicked the doors open. I think I had a bump on my knee and minor injuries. But this is a subcompact car, and mind you, there's a ditch with water for the car, because I mean, there's so many things that could have happened, but in my foolishness, I disobeyed God, and there I was in a circumstance that I shouldn't have been in because I was disobedient. That night, I managed to get out of the car, and for some reason, I managed to find my Bible in the car, and I'm walking up and down Interstate 4 in Orlando, Florida, actually it was Maitland, just north of Orlando, walking back and forth. Lord, I recommit my life to you, Lord. I will never turn away from you again, because that night my life could have been over. But God gave me the privilege and the opportunity to see another day. And here I am from 1991 to now, still praising God. Now, have I had some bumps in the road? Yes. Have I tripped and fell? Yes. But God has never left me, and I continue to seek God for forgiveness and restoration. And God has been faithful in doing that. So that's the joy I go forth in, knowing that I could, that there was a possibility that I couldn't have been here. And but God in His love, God in His amazing grace, He saved me. God promised us that 2021 and forever, that number one, He will return and live with us. Revelation 21:3, He said, "I heard a voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God, there's a dwelling place now among your people. He will dwell with you.'" They will be His people, and God Himself. Well, basically, God is going to be with us forever. God is calling us to a place and a circumstance that is far beyond what we see now. They did a play about the birth of Jesus. The hope of all hope came for us. Because Jesus was born, we have all of these covenants, and we have all of these promises to stand on in 2021. Don't approach 2021 in negativity. Don't approach 2021 in stress. Don't approach 2021 believing what the news tells you. Approach 2021 believing what God has told you. Approach 2021 and doing what God has told you to do in terms of obedience. After this year, your singers, I pray that God, we talked about purpose, I pray that God will continue to direct you into your purpose. If you don't know what you're going to major in, don't stress in it right now, because I guarantee you, your first 2 years of college, you're going to be struggling. I don't want to say struggling, you're going to be completing your basic things, getting your math and your literature and your religion and philosophy courses, getting all your basics out of the way. But one thing God will do when you go forth in obedience, He reveals various things to you. When you go forth in faith, He reveals things to you. But He's not going to reveal too much to you if you're sitting there, "Lord, I'm waiting, Lord, I'm waiting, I'm waiting." But I dare you to get out and stand on His promises. I dare you to get out and walk in His purpose. I dare you to get out and be obedient. And it's in the midst of doing what He's told you to do that He's going to incrementally take you into your purpose, into your hope, and into your future. Jesus came, and He laid His life down. Jesus, His whole purpose was to come and lay His life down, that we would be able to live eternally. His whole purpose, we're talking about a purpose-driven life, His whole purpose was to come for us. His whole purpose was to love us. His whole purpose was to give us a hope. So as we go into 2021, we need to understand. And I just like to quickly review it, because let me tell you one reason that I review, and some of you may get angry or bored that I review things, because the more you hear it, the more you internalize it. The more you internalize, the likelihood of you applying it to your life. God promises that He will guide you. He promises that He will help you when you are tempted. He promises to repay those that hurt you. Take your hands out of it. Let God deal with them. He promises to provide wisdom when you seek Him. He promises to reward your service and your generosity. He promises to give you wisdom. He promises to give purpose to your lives. He promises that His love is everlasting and unchanging. He promises that nothing will separate us. He promises that He will forgive us. He promises that He will deliver us from temptation and struggle. He promises that He will fight for us. He promises us a life filled with joy. And He promises that upon His return, we will live with Him forever. Jesus, and I'm going to go, this is a humbling time. This is a time of reverence. We're going to go before God. And this is your choice whether you're going to partake of this or not. When Jesus was having his final moments with his disciples. He knew that his time, his final moments, his final hours of life, his final moments to going forth in his purpose were ahead of him. And he got with the disciples, and they had their last supper. And I'm not saying this is our last supper, but this is our last communion of the year. And I'm praying right now that you will join us in partaking of the Lord's table. Now, don't let the enemy talk you out of it, because going forth with this has nothing to do with your stature, has nothing to do with where you are. God is saying right now, just go forth, repent. So right now, we're about to pray for forgiveness. So every heart in this room will be clean. So we're eligible, or we're entitled to go forth and partake of the Lord's table. If you bow your heads, please. Lord, we go before you today. We praise you that you sent your son, Jesus. Lord, we don't celebrate Christmas because of the gifts. We celebrate Christmas because of your gift to us. While we were yet lost, you sent your son, Jesus. And we celebrate this, his birth this time of year. But also, we celebrate going forward that we, Lord, we remember your sacrifice. We remember you giving us, giving your life that we may have the privilege of living with you eternally. Lord, we pray right now that you look into our lives and all of the sins that we have in our life, all of the guilt and all the things that we carry, Lord. Lord, we repent. And Lord, we say, forgive us, Lord. Forgive us where we've fallen short, Lord. Forgive us in the mistakes we make. Lord, forgive us when we didn't do the things that you called us to do. Forgive us, Lord. And we go forth with hearts that are clean, hearts that are renewed, hearts going forth in faith right now. In Jesus' name, amen. This is voluntary. I'm going to start with the young ladies. If you want to take communion, one at a time, please.
Child of you, deliverer, will soon be delivered.
scripture in 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 24, verse. Let me read this properly. And he gave thanks. Take your wafer in your hand. And he gave thanks to God for it. And he broke it and said, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In verse 25, he said, in the same way he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is my new covenant between God and his people as an agreement with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you right now for the humbling honor and privilege of sharing and this commemorating and remembering that you were born for us. And we praise you, Lord, that you gave us a gift of your life. You gave us a gift of your salvation. And we praise you for this privilege right now to spend eternity with you. In Jesus' name, amen.